Okay. Hi, good afternoon. My name is Janice, and I'm here to welcome Ilan Pappe to Edinburgh for our conference. As if you need... As if you need telling, Ilan Pappe is an Israeli historian of, amongst other works, the ethnic cleansing of Palestine. So he'll speak for 50 minutes, followed by a Q&A, with plenty of time for reflection. The meeting is scheduled for about 90 minutes, but we can overshoot if necessary. And at the end of the meeting, there will be time for book signing. So join me in giving him a very warm welcome to Edinburgh.
Thank you. Thank you. Good afternoon. Apologies for being late. Some sort of an industrial action in the airport. You always support industrial action, apart on the day that you are flying. Then you think industrial action may be questionable. But in any other day, we always in full solidarity with people who want better pay and better working conditions. I'm very sorry that I missed the interventions before, but I know most of the people who gave the talk and the interventions, and therefore I have a good feeling that I'm not going to repeat, rather compliment what already has been said in this very important day that the PSC Scotland has organized. The term settler colonialism, as maybe you know or heard during the day, or you know from other sources, the term settler colonialism with association or in conjunction with Palestine is not a new, has been done before. The association of the two concept, the concept of the liberation of Palestine and viewing Zionism as settler colonialism, this kind of association, this kind of link has been done before, both by Palestinian intellectuals in Beirut in the early 1960s, in fact, and by some anti-Zionist Jews, most notable among them Maxim Rodinson in 1972, in France. But sometimes terms which are aired and come too prematurely. When settler colonialism was associated with Zionism in the early 60s or even in the early 70s, for most people, activists, Palestinians, people who supported the struggle for liberation, the term looked irrelevant. For most Palestinians who were involved in the struggle of liberation in the 60s and the 70s, there was no fine-tuning between colonialism and settler colonialism. Zionism was colonialism. Fighting against Zionism was anti-colonialism. And the model that was inspiring, or the model that inspired the whole Palestinian liberation movement in the 60s and the 70s, was the FLN, the National Liberation Movement in Algeria. And the very clear target of any anti-colonialist movement in those days, in the 60s and the 70s, was to send the settlers back home and reclaim the homeland that was colonized. And this was more or less the target and the understanding of the Palestinian Liberation Movement, and one can fully appreciated because Zionism was in its first, maybe in its second wave of immigration, and you could still hope that you had the power to reclaim what was taken from you in a long process that had begun in the late 19th century. However, when settler colonialism reappeared very recently again as a very powerful paradigm in the academia, among activists, among Palestinians and anti-Zionist Jews who were writing on the issue, it became a far more attractive and relevant term than it was in the early 60s and the beginning of the 70s of the previous century. The reason is that the fine-tuning, the difference between colonialism and settler colonialism suddenly made sense for the reality in Israel and Palestine at the end of the 20th century, and particularly in our century. So to make clear why settler colonialism is such a powerful paradigm today, such a powerful perspective, we have so many PhD students working on Palestine and settler colonialism. We have journals, we have conferences. It seems to be now the language of many activists inside and outside Palestine. So the kind of the Palestinian movement is almost redefined as an anti-settler colonialist movement rather than an anti-colonialist movement. And it's such an accurate term compared to anti-colonialism. It's far less kind of abstract than the struggle for justice, which is important, for peace, for equality. These are beautiful terms, but they have to be broken down into clear targets and objectives. Whereas when you use the term settler colonialism and you are involved in the struggle against settler colonialism, of course, part of it is the struggle for justice and peace, but there's a clarity about the objectives. There's a clarity about the problem and the way out of it. So let me just say very shortly the difference between colonialism and settler colonialism. You may have heard it, but you've heard different versions maybe, so you just will hear another version, probably the last one for today, so I hope it's not too burdensome. There are three main differences between colonialism and settler colonialism. The first difference is that settler colonialists were not sent by empires to build colonies, but rather dovetailed empires and settled in other people's homeland because they were unwelcome actually in Europe or in the heart of the empires themselves. Most of the settler colonialist projects we know have been initiated by people who had to run away from Europe for different kinds of reasons. Poverty, religious persecution, all kinds of trouble, collective or individual, that made them look for, if you want, in today's terms, one-way ticket out of Europe. Whereas in the classical colonial setup, there was a far more organized relationship between the people who were sent to colonize and the mother country. And this is very important in the 21st century to understand why most of the colonial colonies have been decolonized, but the settler colonial projects are still with us with different degrees of success. The second difference was that whereas the classical colonialist movement were looking for natural resources, raw material, in order to enhance the empire's power, settler colonialists were not looking for the minerals, the gold, the treasures that were outside of Europe. They were looking for a home. And in fact, what really made their encounter with the new countries tragic was that they were not only looking for a home, but also for a homeland. And when they were looking for a homeland and they found that someone else was there, a very dramatic encounter took place between the settlers and the native indigenous population. And I'll come back to that in a moment. And finally, the difference between colonialism and settler colonialism is that colonialist empires wanted to exploit the native. Settler colonialist movements wanted to remove, to get rid of the native. For them, the native was like the stones, the swamps, whatever obstacles stood in the way of building a homeland, these obstacles included the native indigenous people. A colonialist empire saw the native population as manpower that could be used for the benefit of the empire. So there's no real relations of exploitation. There's a relation of annihilation, which is very different. And this is why one of the greatest scholars of settler colonialism, who unfortunately died recently, Patrick Wolfe, talks about settler colonialism as being a project moved by what he calls the logic of the elimination of the native. When he looks at the two American continents, when he looks at Australia, when he looks at New Zealand, he looks at Palestine, he looks at South Africa, he says the settler project there was moved by what he calls the logic of elimination. I would add another logic, because so many of these settlers were themselves victims of persecutions, because they themselves were poor people who suddenly became the masters of someone else's homeland in order to do to the natives, in many ways, what had been done to them. Another logic had to be intact here. And this is the logic of dehumanization. You have to dehumanize the native, to treat them as subhumans in order to do to them something that you yourself suffered from. Dehumanization is an important part of any process of a crime against humanity, whether it is the genocide of people, the ethnic cleansing of people, the dispossession of people. If you, on such grand scale, you eliminate communities, the preliminary act is dehumanizing them. Otherwise, as a human being, as part of such a mechanism, you cannot do the job, so to speak. So these two twin logics of elimination and dehumanization were translated into genocide of the Native Americans in North America, the Native Americans in South America, the Aboriginals in Australia, to a lesser extent, the Maoris in New Zealand. In two places, the logic of elimination took a different form. One is South Africa, and the other one is Palestine. There, the settler communities, for reasons I don't have time to go into, the settler communities decided to get rid of the indigenous native population, not by explicit forms of genocide, but by other means, more sophisticated. And what is interesting in the sophistication, that part of it, it's not the only reason, but part of the complicated way of removing the natives had to do with the self-image of these settler communities, that they are different from other settler communities, that they are not barbaric, that they are far more enlightened, far more civilized than those who were involved in settler colonialism before them. It also, it's interesting that they finally decide on the final act of settler colonialism, that when I say they, I mean the settlers in South Africa and the settlers, the Jewish settlers in Palestine. They actually decide, and this is just historical coincidence, there's no other explanation for it, but they have decided on the final act of settler colonialism in the same year, 1948. The apartheid system was institutionalized in South Africa in 1948, and that was the major means by which the settler community of whites hoped to solve the long problem of settling in someone else's homeland and getting rid of the natives. So they hoped that the apartheid system, with all its complexities, would help the white settler community to retain the settler colonialist project as it had been for years, in a century and in a period after the Second World War, where the world seemed to be a bit impatient about brutal settler colonial project as had been taking place in Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, South America, and North America. In Palestine, the Zionist movement understood very well the historical moment of 1948. 3 years after the Holocaust, the world was quite lenient towards a movement that claimed to be not a settler colonialist movement, but the liberation movement of the Jewish people. So 3 years after the Holocaust, exploiting the disarray in the Arab world, the lack of any leadership to talk about on the Palestinian side because the British have killed them all or expelled them in the 1930s, they understood how to exploit these circumstances in order to try and get rid of as many Palestinians as possible. Now, they have not succeeded. They have not succeeded because of Palestinian steadfastness, because they were not so powerful. There was a small community. After all, in the end of the day, they didn't have such a powerful military power. And despite the reactionary nature of most of the Arab regimes around them, their involvement after the 15th of May 1948 also helped to hold some of the ethnic cleansing operation of the Zionist forces. We should remember that as well. But to say that they have not succeeded is not, of course, to forget and mention that, after all, the tragedy was horrific. I mean, they expelled half of the people's population, they demolished half of Palestine's villages, destroyed half of, not half, 11 out of the 12 towns of Palestine, apart from the town of Nazareth, they totally destroyed not only the 11 towns that existed in Palestine, but all the countryside, the hinterland around these towns. This was a barbaric act of eliminating communities that reminds us of the worst scenes that we see today in Syria in 2016. So the settler colonialist project of, you'll give me, tell me, okay. The settler colonialist project of Zionism in 1948 made a very fundamental move, which on the one hand reminded us of other settler colonialist projects, on the other hand also illustrated to us the uniqueness of the Zionist settler colonial project. But what is the benefit of looking at what the Zionist movement did in 1948 as an act of settler colonialism? What is the benefit of looking at Israeli policies since 1948 until today as a settler colonialist project? And what can we learn for the future about the future if we use, if we apply, if we insist on applying the paradigm of settler colonialism to Israel today and to Zionism in the past? That's the big question that we are all asking ourselves, and I think we are beginning to get some very clear questions. I'll give you one example that I think will illustrate very well how useful the paradigm of settler colonialism is. If you look at the Zionist movement as a settler colonialist movement that needs to get as much of Palestine as possible, and to have in it as few Palestinians as possible, but has to react to the changing circumstances around it, to the 1950s, to the 1960s, to the world international system rules of the game of the late 20th century, during the Cold War, after the Cold War, after 9/11, all these things have to be taken into account. If we look at this in such a way that you have a settler colonialist vision, worldview, and changing circumstances, let's see what happens when you put them together. Let's take the junction of 1967. In most analyses of the war of 1967, the 1967 war is seen as a very important watershed in the history of the Arab-Israeli conflict. In fact, the peace process, to which also the Palestinians were, contributed, the peace process that is dead now, but at the time when it was still alive, was based on the idea that 1967 was the most important year in the conflict. Hence, Palestine was the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. The Palestinians were the people who were living in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. And the peace process was to try and help the Israelis and the Palestinians to reach an agreement about the fate and the future of these territories and these people. This is, in fact, how the conflict is being taught today in most universities in the West. This is how most journalists in Britain, if you ask them in the United Kingdom, if you ask them how do they analyze the conflict, its origins, its causes, the way to solve it, they will talk about 1967 as the most important year, the occupation of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. Peace is finding a solution for the future of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. From the settler colonialist perspective, 1967 is not a very significant year. The significant year is, first of all, 1948, when the settler colonialist project took over 80% of the homeland, kicked out half of the people living there, and already had such a stronghold in Palestine that whether it did succeed in getting the other 20% that were controlled respectively anyway by Egypt and Jordan, not by the Palestinians, was not that crucial. People don't understand it. Was not that crucial for the settler colonialist state to exist. Of course, it was much better from their own perspective to use another historical juncture to take over 100% of the homeland, not to be content with 80%, especially when the Zionist movement, that was a secular movement, became more and more religious after 67. And having the ancient cities of the Bible, which were in the West Bank, was an important part of the Zionist settler colonialism after 67, which was not there before 67. And yet, they also understood, exactly because they were settler colonialists, that they created a problem for themselves by expanding the borders. They kicked out 1 million Palestinians and incorporated 1.5 million Palestinians. And it's only through the settler colonialist paradigm that you can understand not only the Israeli policy that hasn't changed since 1967, but also the way the West is going along with this policy, with this strategy, either because of ignorance, either because of cynicism, I don't know. It depends. The West is a big concept. We're talking about elites, societies, journalists, and so on. Each one of them probably have their own reason for finding it much easier to go along with the Israeli interpretation of what happened rather than with an alternative one, as we are trying to do here today. But from a settler colonialist perspective, indeed the main issue in 1967 was not the occupation of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. For them, it was not an occupation. The world immediately, in fact, and unfortunately quite a lot of Palestinians were buying into the term ihtilal, occupation. This is not occupation. Occupation is when the power that takes over a piece of land, that's how in the West we understand occupation. Of course, maybe in other civilizations and cultures, there's a different meaning. But in the West, occupation is very clear, also in international law. Occupation is when you think that the power that took over a piece of land is going to give it back eventually. That's why the whole international law structure is built on regulating what the occupying power can or cannot do in the occupied territory. And that's why international law is such a dismal failure in the case of Israel and Palestine. The amount of paperwork, energy, hopefully some careers as well, that were built on applying the international law to the case of Palestine is based on a totally misunderstanding about the nature of the Israeli control over the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. People like my good friend Norman Finkelstein, who really believed that you should, or Noam Chomsky, that you should stick to international law, fail to understand the nature of the Zionist project, really. If you think that international law is relevant in any way to what Israel is doing in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, and has been doing 67, it means there's something wrong in the way you understand the settler colonialist nature of Zionism. Because it's a settler colonialist project, it could easily, when I say it, I mean the elite that takes decision inside Israel, could easily, in 1967, look at the West Bank. Maybe they had some doubts about the Gaza Strip. They were not sure they wanted the Gaza Strip. As a settler state, the Gaza Strip is not benefiting Israel. That's part of the problem, but we'll leave it maybe to the QA. But the West Bank, it was very clear. The historical opportunity of taking over the West Bank with the population in it is a natural progression of the settler colonial project. So what do you do with 1.5 million people, now 3.5 million people, that you don't want from your settler colonialist perspective? We know what you did in 1948. In 1948, you tried to kick out as many of the undesirables. But in 67, you cannot do it. It's a different world. It's a different historical circumstances. So the Israelis take three decisions that guide all the Israeli governments, regardless of whether they are from the left, from the right, from the center. There's a total consensus about it. Three decisions which are very important. One decision is we cannot massively expel the Palestinians from the West Bank as we did from the rest of Palestine. 67 is not 48. So they, although Israel, of course, massively expelled quite a lot of people from the West Bank since 1967, but it doesn't come close to what they did in 1948. The second decision is, if we don't expel these people, what would be, they asked themselves, what would be the fate of the territory? And they answered very clearly. The territory has to be part of Israel. There was a big debate in Israel, still is a big debate in Israel. How do you maintain this annexation? Not occupation. Occupation is an irrelevant term. How do you maintain this annexation? The Labour Party, what is called the left in Israel, the peace camp says, for the sake of good relationship with the world, we should never annex de jure. We should not officially annex the West Bank. We should find the ways of keeping the West Bank inside Israel. We should even talk about a peace process. There's no harm in it. As Noam Chomsky rightly said, he understood it better than any one of us before we all kind of woke up to it, when he called the peace process as a process to nowhere. It was very clear. Israel was building a peace process that mesmerized the rest of the world and also some of the Palestinians in order to create this kind of fog around what most Israelis, at least after 67, thought was the best way of keeping the West Bank, which was a matrix of indirect and direct control, talking about autonomy, allowing one mayor to be elected, killing another mayor. It's a business. I'm publishing a book very soon called The Bureaucracy of Evil about that period. It's a bureaucracy of evil. Thousands of people were involved in it in 1967. Then 10,000, 100,000 of people are involved in maintaining a matrix which its main object is to annex without officially annexing the West Bank. So that's the second decision. You don't expel the people, but you don't officially annex the territory, but you keep it. You keep the West Bank. The third decision has to be asked. So if the people are not expelled and the territories are not really part of Israel, although with the Jewish settlements, some of it is already part of even officially Israel, what is the fate of the people? And they say already in 67, very clearly, these will be citizenless citizens. And there's a famous dialogue with the then Minister of Defense, Moshe Dayan, who is asked, for how long do you think people, millions of people, can live without basic human rights and civil rights? As you defined, he defined, it's Dayan's definition, citizenless citizens. So he was asked, for how long? We said, at least 50 years, which is this year. At least 50 years, and if necessary, another 50 years. In other words, he was saying to those people who were at least morally bothered by this issue, I don't understand what it bothers you. You know, the settler colonialist state has ways of keeping millions of people without citizenship, without basic human rights, without civil rights. If you do it rightly, if you cover it up with the peace process, then, you know, you don't you're not a target for the world's rebuke or criticism, and you can continue maintaining. It's not even building facts on the ground. That's where the messianic movement of settlement, Gush Emunim, at least kind of confused the analysts of the situation. It's true, for them it was very important to annex the West Bank, to put facts on the ground. The elite in Israel that makes decision doesn't need facts on the ground. What they need is a good mechanisms that maintain the what I call the biggest prison upon earth. And this big prison has two versions. There is an open prison. If the Palestinians go along with this kind of reality as a permanent reality, then it's an open prison. Palestinians can work in Israel. They can have some autonomy. They can have relative freedom of movement and so on. If they resist, as they did in 1987 and 2000 and recently, if they resist, it becomes a maximum security prison. Gaza is our horrific example of what happens if the Israelis decide that a certain Palestinian community does not play according to the rules. They use most of the most lethal weapons. This army, which is the strongest army in the Middle East and the fourth strongest army in the world, they use the most lethal weapons against the most against a population cramped within 2% of Palestine in a way, and we know the consequences of that kind of punitive action by Israel. So, to sum up, do I have some?
You've got another 15 minutes.
Okay, I don't have to use all the 15 minutes. I'm just, as long as we'll leave more time for a QA. In order to sum up this idea of settler colonialism, you can understand now much better also the treatment of the Palestinian community inside Israel by Israel. Again, it's not as analysts, if you look at modules and courses in universities, it's very interesting. The case of the Palestinian minority in Israel is being taught in courses about democracies, you know, the relationship between minority and majority, ethnic democracies, and so on. It shouldn't be taught within these paradigms. It should be part of the settler colonialist history of the world and the particular settler colonialism project in Palestine. Until 1967, before Israel decided to expand the settler colonial state over the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, until then, Israel was left with a small Palestinian minority, which was not supposed to be there. According to the plan of the Zionist movement, Israel was supposed to be empty and clean of any Palestinian in it. But for reasons that we are all, as historians, are now beginning to figure out, a small minority was left. Immediately, they were treated as the enemy from within, a harsh military rule, the kind of people in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip recognized from 1967 onwards. A harsh rule was imposed on the Palestinians inside Israel until 1967. And that year, because there was a larger Palestinian community that Israel had to attend to, the Palestinians of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, they moved the same regime of military rule from the Galilee, the Nakab, from inside Israel, and imposed it with the same people, imposed it on the Palestinians in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. The Israelis are very good at it. They're very efficient in it. As you probably know, for a certain period of time, Israel controlled the Palestinian refugee camps of Lebanon during its two invasions. The same people who were part of the military rule in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip were transferred to Lebanon, and they didn't need any introduction. They were already, if you want, qualified how to deal with a Palestinian community, regardless where it is, whether it's in Lebanon, in the Galilee, or in the West Bank. Now, the Palestinian community in Israel seemed to the Israelis as a kind of a solved issue between 1967 and until 2000, as if this particular community does not undermine the settler colonial state, the settler colonial that needs, remember, I'm coming back to the beginning of my talk, towards the end, there is a logic of elimination that sometimes is being achieved not by physical elimination. You can eliminate, as we know from the West, you can eliminate people by not seeing them, by enclaving them as they do in the Galilee and the Nakab, by enclaving them in communities, by not allowing them to expand, by not allowing them to move. The Israelis felt that the Palestinian community in Israel was a solved case for the settler colonial state, and they needed all the energy and the know-how to deal with the people of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. They were surprised in 2000 to learn that actually that the Palestinian communities on both sides of what is called the Green Line actually have not succumbed to the settler colonial state, that they resist the settler colonial state. They do it in different ways, with different levels of courage, with different levels of determination, with a lot of people who still succumb individually to the power of the settler colonial state, not surprisingly, right? Including some political elites. But nonetheless, that the basically, and I think this is, with this I would end, this is particularly true about the younger generation of Palestinians today. The biggest success of the settler colonialist project of Zionism was fragmenting the Palestinians into five different groups. The West Bank, the Gaza Strip, the Palestinians in Israel, the Palestinians in the refugee camps, and the Palestinians in the exilic communities. Five communities. Each one of them developed its own political agenda. This was the greatest Israeli success. The younger generation, maybe because of Facebook, maybe because of the internet, maybe because of the technological ability to transgress and bypass barriers, physical barriers that Israel is imposing, maybe because of that, is now defragmenting the Palestine reality. And I think that if this process will continue, if this process will be successful, the settler colonial state of Israel would not be able to use any of its very effective methods that it had used until today. The effectiveness of the methods depends on the level of fragmentation within the Palestinian community. And of course, we should not forget that all of this needs the support from the outside. But at least in 2016, looking at the BDS, looking at the successes of the BDS, looking at the way the world reacts to the BDS, at least we can say that one part of the puzzle that is needed to be composed in order to create a different reality in Israel and Palestine, one puzzle is already there. Yes, it has to be strengthened, it has to be better coordinated. I'm sure all of us have some constructive criticism to tell people who are involved with the BDS movement, but the direction is there, and it's unstoppable. Nobody would be able to stop it. But this would be a meaningless international solidarity act if the defragmentation, the ability of the Palestinian community to overcome the fragmentation, would not be translated into an anti-settler colonialist movement that is adapted to the realities of the 21st century, not to the slogans of the 1950s and the 1960s. An anti-settler colonialist movement that puts human rights and civil rights at its very center. This is necessary not just for Palestine. This is necessary for Syria. It is necessary for Iraq. It is necessary for Yemen. It is necessary for Libya. Palestine, the struggle in Palestine should be the struggle for freedom and rights for everyone who lives in the Middle East. Thank you.
To invite people to ask questions. I'll take three questions at a time, followed by three answers. And if you can keep your questions short and succinct, please. Thank you. Okay. Okay. Okay, first one. Jimmy, the lady.
Thank you. I've got a question. You said the elite in Israel that don't need the facts on the ground philosophy, or didn't need it, that they needed a system to maintain an open prison for the Palestinians. If the Palestinians complied, it would be an open prison. If they resisted, it would become a maximum security prison, which is what we're seeing. My question is, don't you think that this was the plan all along? Did they really think that the Palestinians would not resist, that it was possible to keep a population in an open prison? And how does that fit with the progressive land theft in the West Bank? Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does.
Okay. Yeah. Hi, thank you. I'm a bit intrigued with one of your comments when you said that we cannot consider the 1967 as an occupation. It's a kind of annexation according to the settler colonialist paradigm. And then you mentioned something along the lines that actually you are skeptical, perhaps I have misunderstood you, but correct me if I'm mistaken, you are skeptical about the interest of Israel in Gaza Strip within this settler colonialist paradigm. Now, according to your rationale, how would you then explain that Israeli attacks against Gaza Strip, like several attacks, military attacks, the siege? If Israel has no interest in Gaza Strip, then how would you explain what's happening in Gaza within your settler colonialist paradigm? Thank you.
Yeah, very good question.
The third question to the lady in the third row with the pink top.
My question really is about the refugees in Lebanon, because I'm very much involved with them. Because it's the future, what is to happen with the future of these refugees in Lebanon who are expanding minute by minute, and the Syrian refugees have landed in with them, and many of these Takfiri groups like Fatah al-Islam and so forth who have infiltrated them. What do you see the future of these camps could possibly be?
Thank you for excellent questions. Abigail, I'll start with your two questions. I think the plan altogether was for, and I think maybe I was misunderstood, I think from the very beginning, and here the beginning is 1967, when you talk about the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, from the very beginning it was clear to the policymakers that they were running a huge prison. It was very clear. I mean, you can see from the... have you heard the beginning? Yeah, I'm shouting anyway. Yeah. Okay. From the very beginning, I think the discourse was of a prison. And therefore, it was taken for granted that there will be periods where, if you want, the inmates would rebel, where you will have to use severe punishments. In fact, the whole discourse, as you know from Hebrew, the most important kind of metaphor that all the Israeli policymakers used about the West Bank and the Gaza Strip from 67 until today is the carrot and the stick. The carrot and the stick. And this whole idea is that the carrot, if you want, the inducement not to act. They knew exactly that what they are giving, in the words of the late Yitzhak Rabin, was to give them something which is a bit better from what they had. It doesn't have, of course, there was never an idea of humanizing them, giving them equal rights, treating them as people who own the land, who are part of the land. No, this was out of the question anyway. So within the logic of dehumanization, there was, the logic of elimination. Yes, you could have the best you could offer, the colonized, if you want. That's why I think the whole idea of occupation has nothing to do with this. Occupation has a general treatment of the occupied. You don't differ between the occupied. Israel has, I don't remember how many, I think one of the NGOs counted, there are about 15 different legal statuses just in the Greater Jerusalem area. Just in the Greater Jerusalem area. And if you expand it to the West Bank, it's more than 50 or 60 different colors to your car, different numbers that the Israelis only know what they mean, different status of in the same neighborhood in Jerusalem. You can be regarded as a part of the West Bank or part of Jerusalem, depends on the demographic balance of power at that moment for Israel. This whole matrix, this whole dehumanization that you nowadays can see in Kalandia when you cross the checkpoint, where everything is done through mechanical and metal voices, you don't even see the soldiers when you cross and come in, is part of the project. I hope that one day Gideon Levy, the journalist, would write his memoir, because one of the things he wrote once, but he should put it, maybe he even put it in one of his books, I don't remember. But as, I don't know if you know, he used to be the spokesperson for Shimon Peres when he was Minister of Defense. And he witnessed the establishment, the erection of the first checkpoint in the West Bank, back in 68, 69. And he told Peres, what are we building here? Because there's no shade against the sun, against the rain, there are no toilets. There's nothing here that can attend to normal the requirements and needs of a normal human being. And Peres said, but that's exactly the idea. That's exactly the idea of a checkpoint. And I think this whole, you know, kind of psychological side of this, of the way that Israelis see as a reality, running this mega prison for years to come, and so many people are employed in this bureaucracy, is something that for most Israelis looks very natural. Or as Foucault would put it, it's taken for granted reality. They would never question the immorality of it until we will force them to see this immorality with campaigns such as the BDS. As the Lancet, I think it's part of it. Because we have to remember, the Israeli political elite ran into trouble when a messianic group of settlers emerged in 68, Gush Emunim. They didn't want this movement of religious Jews who suddenly saw the West Bank as the repeat of Palestine in the 19th century. It really troubled the Israeli policymakers. They didn't like this idea that there's what they call the partisan settlement. They wanted a very structured, strategic way of maintaining the colonization. So they ran, it happens, by the way, to a lot of settler colonialist movement, vigilantes who causes trouble to the main settler colonial project. The land theft, as you know, there are two kinds of land thefts. There's the official land theft, which is part of the framing the prison, if you want, building the prison in a way that can ensure control. And there is a land theft that is done by the settlers that the Israelis, in hindsight, legitimize, not so much because it fits, I think, the program, as much as they don't want to have a kind of a civil war with these thieves. And they would rather let them be there. The Gaza Strip, the lady who asked about the Gaza Strip. What I meant when I said that the Israelis didn't have, probably I should have said it clear, they don't have a clear idea what to do with the West, with the Gaza Strip. I got your question. I'm just starting there. I'm saying they have a clear idea what to do with the West Bank. And because, now, you have to remember why the Gaza Strip was created. Israel, if you look at the borders of the Gaza Strip, you have to ask yourself, what are these two very clear lines that create a strip of 2% of Palestine suddenly in July 1948? Was never before, there wasn't a Gaza Strip. Nobody talked about the Gaza Strip. There was the city of Gaza, who was part of the Beersheba municipality, regional control. And Gaza itself was an important city. So nobody talked about the Gaza Strip. There wasn't a strip. Israel needed a receptor that would incorporate the hundreds of thousands of Palestinians they intended to expel from the south of Palestine, from the line that sort of kind of fictional line. If you take a fictional line between Jaffa and Jerusalem and you go down, they knew that all these, and this was a great success of the Israelis, unlike in the Galilee, they succeeded of expelling almost all of them. And they needed to push them somewhere. They wanted to push them into Jordan and Egypt, and the two countries did not allow it. So they pushed them into the Gaza Strip, created this kind of strip, and allowed the Egyptians to take it over. And even the Egyptians did never annex the Gaza Strip, whereas the Jordanians annexed the West Bank officially in 1950. So for them, the Gaza Strip, when they occupied it, was a problem that they could not easily control as they controlled the West Bank. The result, when a settler colonial state doesn't know what to do with millions of people incarcerated in this huge prison called Gaza, the result, unfortunately, is that if they are not quiet and they don't reconcile to this horrible fate that awaits them and they resist, Israel punishes them as it did in 2006, 2009, 2012, 2014. This is why I called it incremental genocide. Because even if the Israelis do not mean, if you want, to genocide the people, the outcome of their policies, as was declared very clearly in the United Nations report about 6 months ago, that in 2020 Gaza would be a place where human beings could not survive. The Israelis know about this report and are not worried about it. And I think that's part of the settler colonial logic of elimination, that its most horrible manifestation is indeed, as you said, in the Gaza Strip. Finally, about the refugees in Lebanon, which of course is a huge problem, I agree. I think that we have to differentiate as activists, and I'm talking now as an activist, not as a prophet, I don't know what the future holds, and not even as an historian. But I think we should differentiate between two issues, but we should be very serious about them. One is, I think, all of us who are committed to the struggle for justice in Palestine always supported the right of return. We never had any preconditions, we never were wishy-washy about it. Our support for the right of return was clear, without any conditions. And we always said it's up to the refugees themselves to decide whether they want to have the right or not, but nobody but them can deny. This is on both a symbolic level, but also an important, I think, meaningful level. Unfortunately for all of us, something happened now in Syria and Lebanon, and this is a new refugee problem. And we should find a way of connecting the rebuilding of Syria with the rebuilding of Palestine. I think we're making a mistake if we're not connecting. Because what's happening in Syria is connected to the same colonial setup that in 1916 created a Jewish state in Palestine, 1917 created a Jewish state in Palestine. I think the fact that the world has not even noticed that among Syria's neighbors, the only country that did not receive even one refugee was Israel. Whereas the community of Palestinians in Israel said to the government, we'll take them. They are our relatives, they are our cousins, they are our sisters and brothers, and the only country, and there was not even one, nobody mentioned it, that the strongest economically state around Syria didn't even take one refugee in a world that at least ethically thinks that people should take these life-seeking people and give them shelter. Israel has not even taken one person. So I think this, we should connect this without giving you a clear answer how to solve it yet. But I think if we connect this to other issues such as the one-state solution in Palestine, the struggle for one democratic state in Palestine, I think all these issues have bearing on the future of the Palestinian refugees in Lebanon, both for those who would want to stay there and both for those who would want to come back to Palestine or seek life elsewhere. I think it's the nature of the regime that will exist in places such, which is today Israel and Palestine and Syria and Lebanon, which will have the most important bearing on the future of the Palestinian refugees in Lebanon.
Okay. Any other questions? Gentlemen at the front of the beige jacket.
I was interested in your point about annexation. There's a difference between occupation and annexation. And we've been in contact with a senior Israeli recently about whether what the concept of the centenary of the Balfour Declaration is a thing that would be of interest or relevant within Israel. And he says the whole word at the moment is occupation. And this is a guy who started, one of the people started this CISO, Save Israel, Stop the Occupation. And I just wondered what you thought of CISO.
Gentlemen, just behind.
Thank you very much for what you said. When you link things with Syria, this raises a question in my mind. The settler colonial project has to be seen, surely, as part of a bigger imperial project. It may be different, but going back to the Balfour Declaration and how we look at it, raises that question that still there were, quite apart from the attitude of the settlers, there was the attitude of the great powers to the Middle East. And so there is a fundamental wider problem which in our activism we can't forget.
Mm-hmm. One more. Lady with the purple top.
UJAX itself has to do with the whole because UJAX
start from the beginning, won't hear you.
I'm wondering what sort of role UJAX has to play in
the whole
eugenics, what role?
Someone raised a point there in the last question. It's really all to do with the elite at the end of the day are just trying to control, the world, and eugenics is one of the things that we use to control the world. So some of the things that are happening, like South Africa, also happening in Israel as well. You've got forced sterilization. Ethiopian women who report that Israel forced sterilization on them, and we have segregation, for example, in Iran as well. So there is quite a few examples of population control.
I got the point.
Which started actually in America.
Can we just wrap up the question? Sorry.
I think the question is clear, yeah.
Okay,
thank you. Shall we take it?
Do you want one more? Okay, one more question.
One more.
Jimmy.
If settler colonialism is based on a logic of annihilation and dehumanization, what does decolonization mean in the context of colonialism? Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. Roger, to your question. The movement you're talking about was created by two ex-Israeli diplomats who were deeply involved in the Oslo process. One of them, and the most important among them, is Alon Liel, who was the Director General of the Foreign Ministry and ambassador in certain countries. It's an interesting, I think, swan's song of liberal Zionism. And I'll explain what I mean by that. There is, the liberal Zionism is a bizarre concept. It's moral. You cannot be a liberal Zionist. There cannot be a Jewish democracy. These things do not work together. And liberal Zionism was an important part of Israeli politics. It was the idea that words are enough to square a circle, even if you can't square a circle. So you can ethnically cleanse the Palestinians in 1948, and by that disallow most of the Palestinians who would have voted in 1949 against the Jewish state, disallow them to vote, and claim that the democratic will of the people was in 49 that Israel should be a Jewish state. That's what liberal Zionism is about. Liberal Zionism is the way Israel explains its most brutal actions as living within the context of democracy and human rights and civil rights. This is where the term enlightened occupation comes from, or purity of arms. And there's many. There's a whole dictionary of such Israeli oxymorons. And I think liberal Zionism is totally irrelevant, and rightly so, for most Israelis. They say, it's gone, there's no need for this. We are controlling the West Bank. We are controlling the Gaza Strip. There's no peace process. Nothing happens. We're okay. That's how they see it. We are fine. Yes, there is BDS, which they're not sure yet how dangerous it is. Probably they feel something because they are definitely preoccupied with the idea of the BDS. But they found again a way of words to explain to themselves what the BDS is all about. They said the BDS is not the moral conscious position of people who say enough is enough in Israel. It's new anti-Semitism. So liberal Zionists were the people who I think were responsible for this launderette of words. And in 2016, there's no need for them. Either you are an anti-Zionist, which means you belong to a very small group of Jews who still live in Israel. Most of us live outside of Israel. Or you belong to the mainstream Israeli political kind of consensual world. Yes, they have different parties, I think 13 among them, between Likud and the left Zionist group that is still left. But in terms of the settler colonialist project, they think the same. They have some tactical differences of opinion, but no ideological or moral issues, right? So here comes the group that you're mentioning and says the last thing that can save liberal Zionism is the two-state solution. And the main obstacle, they think, is Netanyahu. They think that somehow the world would have reconciled to their own idea of two-state solution, which is two Bantustans in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip with a flag in Ramallah, no right of return for the refugees, no real sovereignty, no solution for the problem of the Palestinians inside Israel. But if you want the best of the open prisons Israel can offer in 2016, it wouldn't have worked anyway. But they don't have customers in Israel for that. And they thought maybe the BDS that looked at them very effective could be convinced to focus just on that, on forcing Israel to leave the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, go back to the logic of Oslo, of the Oslo process, that Palestinians would be very happy to live in two Bantustans without the right of return, as long as there is a flag in Ramallah of Palestine, and 50% of the West Bank is treated as if it is an independent sovereign state of Palestine. So I think that's where they come from. It's anachronism. I mean, keep in touch with them. There will be a distinct species. So it will be interesting to hear you in many years to come about them. The great powers and imperialism. I think it's important to mention that settler colonialism every now and then assisted itself by imperial interest, but quite often struggled against imperial interest. Remember the Boer Wars. Remember the American Revolution. These are white settlers who thought that the imperial interest and their own interest did not coincide. That happened also in Palestine. The Zionist movement also fought against the British mandate, not just against the Palestinians. And that's very logical for the settler colonialist movement in its relationship with colonial powers at its very beginning, and also its relationship with imperial powers. So I think that anyone who simplified the relationship between Israel and the United States as Israel spearheading American imperialism, let's get over it. It's too simplistic for a much more complex relationship between America and Israel. The relationship which says Israel has a carte blanche in Palestine but cannot interfere in what America is doing in the rest of the Middle East. It's a far more complicated and sophisticated relationship. And one thing we should not do is take a teleological determinist view on Israel's relationship with the United States. Look at history. It's very interesting. In the 50s, America, even before BDS, America sanctioned Israel, stopped aid to Israel, because Israel refused to implement the right of return. I'm sure you didn't know that. The sanction, Israel did not get any aid because it refused to allow the Palestinian refugees to return. That was between 1952 to 1956. In 1956, America forced Israel to get out of Egypt. It said to Israel, we cede our diplomatic relations with you if you don't take your troops out of the Sinai Peninsula. Now, they didn't do it because they were part of the socialist world, or they were a big Palestine Solidarity Committee in Washington. They still did horrible things in the Middle East at the time. I'm not saying that they toppled Mossadegh in Iran, they helped all the wrong people to get into power in the rest of the Arab world. I'm not saying that this didn't happen. But it's very interesting that the issue of Palestine, if you simplify it in its relationship with the United States, you can get wrong the American way of dealing with Palestine. So it's important to take that into account. Now, eugenics and sterilization, and I'm aware of the work done in America, the book, of course, by the famous Davis, Angela Davis, about how these policies were used against the African Americans. To tell you the truth, I know of one or two research that claims that such a policy is intact, both vis-a-vis vis-a-vis the Palestinians in Israel and against the Ethiopian in Israel. Somehow, but this is not out of any analysis or study or inquiry, I'm just giving you my evaluation. Zionism is a settler colonialist project, does not need eugenics in order to implement its version of the logic of elimination. It has enough means of trying to achieve what it always wanted to achieve, which is to have as much of Palestine as possible with as few Palestinians as possible in it. That doesn't mean that what you say is not correct. I'm just saying that I don't know about this and so on. And the final question, what does decolonization therefore means? Well, I think we are, at least theoretically, we are clear about it. Politically, how to implement it, it doesn't depend only on us who are sitting here and elsewhere. I think it's very clear that you can start by saying what is not decolonization and move from there to what is decolonization in 2016. A two-state solution is not decolonization. All the ideas that were at the heart of what is called the peace process since 1967 were a waste of time and energy that had nothing to do, were totally irrelevant to the problem on the ground. So we know what decolonization is not. In very general terms, I think that if we are successful, and I'm part of this attempt in Palestine and outside of Palestine, to create at least a one democratic state discourse that would be adopted also by the political forces who are now representing the liberation movement. If we can help everyone who needs to help, the help to redefine the Palestine liberation movement as a movement that would create democracy for all between the River Jordan and the Mediterranean, normal life for all, based on human rights and civil rights, with the implementation of the right of return. I think that's a pretty acceptable version of decolonization, that despite all the differences of opinion we may have about other things in life, we would be quite happy to see this happening in our lifetime, and we would not complain. And then we can teach about Israeli settler colonialism in our history classes and not in our activists' meetings.
Okay. Okay, I'm sorry, that's all we've got time for just now. Can I just say, there is literature at the back of the room, but can I ask you to stay in your seats for a few last words, and a few last words from Ilan, and thank him again for joining us.
I said what I had to
okay.
say.
Okay,
Sophia. Thanks very much, Janice. Thank you for your patience. If you just give us a few moments to just finish with a few last words. Omar opened with some words about the importance of action and reflection. That one without the other really isn't enough, and we've spent a long day here really reflecting on some new ideas and discussing a lot of what we've been discussing for quite a while. I've got a few words to say, but first I'd like to invite Issam Hijawi. Issam is chair of the Association of Palestinian Communities in Scotland. And I'll just say a few brief words about the Balfour Declaration and the anniversary that's coming up.
Good afternoon. I know that a long day, but I will be brief as I can. You know that going along with what's been happening today, we have to face with the truth. And one of the most important, crucial truth for us as Palestinians is 2nd of November 2017, Balfour Declaration. So next year, it will be 100 years. We believe that this 100 year is not only complicity of the British Empire until now, but it is a crime. So how to deal with this centenary? We initiated our campaign which with many partners worldwide on a very clear aims. The campaign would include a piece of paper, introduction about the British involvement and role in creating the Palestinian problem, and ending with three demands to the British Parliament and government: to recognize their crimes, which from our point of view as Palestinians, they've been committed knowingly, they were illegal, immoral, not to mention only Balfour, but before Balfour, in connection with Sykes-Picot, Hussein McMahon correspondence, the mandate in 1922, the whole period of the mandate, where early in the morning, Ben White mentioned one truth, that's from March 1948 to May 1948, 220 villages and towns, they've been under the nose and the ears and the knowledge and the complicity of the British mandate forces, they've been demolished and the people, they've been forced out. This representing 60% of the whole refugee we counting now. This document will be signed as many as the 12 to 13 million Palestinians worldwide, based on the very fact which Ilan mentioned. It's one people and one cause. So Palestinian, this fragmentation, 1948, West Bank, blah, 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 it doesn't exist for us. This will be presented to the Parliament on the 2nd of November 2016, and hopefully we will manage to collect from the UK more than 100,000 signatures to force the British Parliament to debate the issue. There's another initiative in coordination with the Palestinian Authority. Hopefully they will go to the end of the road. They wanted to make a legal case against Britain. Hopefully they'll carry on. So this is the initiative, and obviously I'm not going to ask you, please join. I'm asking you as a Scottish, Mr. Arthur James Balfour's grave is about 20 kilometers from here. Okay? I do believe that here in Scotland we share a common history as well. So I do expect support. So please do get in touch with me. I will be staying there at the end of the sessions. If anybody would like to get involved, you are more than welcome. And thank you.
Thanks very much, Issam. I should have introduced myself. I've been sort of pottering about all day. My name is Sophia McLeod. I'm chair of Scottish Palestine Solidarity Campaign. We've heard a lot today, and Omar's presentation was very powerful, and it's really unfortunate we couldn't get him here today, and we heard the reasons why. We heard Mahmoud, and thank you for stepping in and giving that very powerful speech. It was, I think, very important, as has already been said, for us to hear those words from Palestinian about resistance and resilience, but also the need for us to participate and to contribute to the Palestinian struggle, because we face challenges ourselves, certainly nowhere near the same, in a very different situation, you know, very, very small challenges in comparison. But, you know, there are challenges to us in terms of being organized, using the resources that we have, which are very limited, tolerance in terms of dealing with each other and trying to find a ways forward in all the different campaigns. But we have seen an increase in pro-Israel organisation on the ground, certainly in Scotland, and I know elsewhere. In Scotland, that's been based since 2014 on a Christian Zionist organising being the base of organising in Scotland. And we know through freedom of information and through other inquiries that pro-Israel groups, including the Israeli embassy, are lobbying the Crown Office, the Scottish Government and others and our elected representatives to criminalise BDS. And so a brief announcement. We'll end a very active week on the 19th next week, when a couple of our members will hear the decision of a sheriff in Glasgow on whether he accepts an okay to answer, and that's in relation to a BDS action on Dead Sea products. Israeli Dead Sea products. So I invite you to Glasgow Sheriff Court, 10 a.m. on the 19th of August. So that's another day for your diary. Thanks very much to our speakers. Thank you, Ilan. It's been really fantastic. The first time I heard Ilan, I just thought it's, you know, sometimes, I think, especially on the issue of Israel-Palestine, it's so, there's so much to it. Ilan's presentation makes it very clear, certainly for me, and I think it's really important for us to have clarity in our ideas and to discuss them further. But I hope today, in relation to the whole issue of settler colonialism, this is just one day, a marker in which we discuss it, but it has to be a continuing discussion in terms of discussing these ideas and discussing the relationship in terms of our activism, but also in terms of how we discuss with institutions, political parties, trade unions, etc., in order to break through, for example, the default position of two-state solution. You know, this not challenging the idea of what is Israel Zionism, and we see that, we have seen that increasingly out in the open, and I think that's been a good thing, but we have to be equipped in order to engage with those discussions. So thanks very much, Ilan. Thanks very much, Mahmoud. Again, Ben White and Omar will pass on greetings, solidarity to Omar from the conference. Also, I'd like to thank our facilitators today. There's a lot of work for Palestine in Scotland and elsewhere, a lot of different organisations and institutions and activists. We have Janice, who's very active and nervous. Very experienced in terms of chairing committees and meetings, but a bit nervous about chairing this meeting. So a hand for Janice for supporting the conversation. And also Doris from BDS Berlin and Adie from Manchester Palestine Action. One thing that Scottish PSC has really wanted for our activists and branches to understand is that we are linked in. We have to be linked in because we are scattered around the country, very much a grassroots organisation. And sometimes when you're sitting in a meeting and there's a few of you and you think, well, there's nothing much we can achieve because there's too few of us. But we have to sort of be able to relate to each other and see what else, see the bigger picture. And that's really important, not just in Europe and the UK, but if you look to the US, you know, a lot of people think there's not much happening in the US, but I think they're way ahead in terms of divestment, in terms of the churches taking positions on pensions investments. And so thank you also to Kate, who spoke in the panel discussion. Because the Church of Scotland and the Iona community is part of the Church is really taking forward some really important debates around BDS and around the right of return and around Palestinian rights. Sam Macartney, again, as a representative of the trade union movement, who've been very strong on the issue of Palestine. Sam, in particular, from UNISON Scotland, has really facilitated a lot of those actions. UNISON is very strong in working with us in the divestment campaign, on the arms trade, investments in the pension funds in Scotland as well, and he mentioned the sports boycott. Eirik Scandrett, who's one of the organisers of this conference, Friends of the Air Scotland, Scottish Green Party, and also a trade unionist with UCU Scotland, but really somebody who's really taken the message, and this is what we want. We hope that these sorts of events and discussions, that we hope you'll be able to take back to your organisation and institutions and have these discussions and debates and push through practical, effective support for solidarity and effective solidarity, and this is exactly what Eirik has done. Together with other Scottish Green Party members, the Scottish Green Party has a position on Israel-Palestine in terms of framing it in relation to settler colonialism, but support for BDS as well, and that is the only party that has taken that position as far as I know to date. I'm going to stop talking in a minute. So thank you very much for all the speakers and facilitators today. Ilan will be signing books in the back of the room. There's some practical matters in terms of the books. I forgot what I was going to say. For dinner, anyone who has signed up for dinner, please see Angus at the end, but we're going down to Haymarket, to Omar Khayyam, I think, down there. So I'm going to invite Mick Napier to the stage to just give us a few brief words on what's going to be happening in the next few days, specifically in relation to the Fringe on the 17th, which is Wednesday.
By not playing on the stage. Let's start off with something really fantastic. Hillary Clinton had to reveal some emails, 4,000 emails. We were never supposed to read them. The Scotsman ran them on a front page. She set up a special group in the bowels of the State Department in Washington in 2009 to defeat the boycott activities in Edinburgh, where we forced the Edinburgh International Film Festival to return money to the Israeli embassy. We were blissfully unaware that 20 people in Edinburgh with a budget of 500 quid were actually set, a special group was set up in Washington to try to defeat us. And they failed! Challenges that we're going to, that we have faced for a very, very long time. Because of 10 years of boycott successes, the Israeli embassy, through its front organisation, Stand With Us and Scottish Friends of Israel, is organising an openly propagandistic event a few hundred yards from here. All day long, on Wednesday, they will have Krav Maga demonstrations, they'll have a happy, chirpy Bedouin in a tent serving coffee. They'll have people proving that Israel is a very benign place for minority. That will go on from 10 a.m. till about 10 p.m. We need to demonstrate vigorously and continuously throughout the day on Wednesday outside Central Hall near here, because they see this as an inaugural event, and if it succeeds on Wednesday, they will be inserting themselves into the fringe year upon year upon year. I don't know that we can stop them on Wednesday, but if there's a big, vigorous protest, then we can try to make sure that they don't come back after that. So please join us on the demonstration on Wednesday. It's one of the biggest things that we've had to face for a long time. And to go to the embassy on the means, there's a French group arriving in a half an hour or so. They do fantastic street theatre in support of Palestine and against Israeli repression in Paris. They're coming to give their best for the next 3 days here in the fringe. The tremendous people from Manchester and from Germany are going to join us as well. For God's sake, we want to make sure there's a lot of Scots there. If you can help us on Sunday morning, Sunday afternoon, you don't have to act, right? Some of us will be, we've got actors in the room here, but if you can help us to leaflet, if you can help us to play a loud PA system mimicking the bombing of Gaza and so on, then there's a role for you. Please help us morning or afternoon, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. We're going into the fringe. We're going to push boycott. We're going to push cultural boycott. Please help us. You've consumed tremendous speakers here today. Now let's turn it into action over the next 3 days. See me before you go. And on your way out, Jerry, Jillian, Eleni and others will be making eye contact. We want you to empty your pockets. We really need the money. The Israelis have set up a 100 million shekel fund, 100 million shekels to fight BDS. Sheldon Adelson, £300, a condemned veal, is a mogul in Los Angeles. He organised an anti-BDS conference, $1 million to get in, and they raised $35 million. You don't look like the same audience, the same demographic, but please give mightily on your way out. Thank you very much.
Kosovo audience. Thanks for. Got a few more noises in the room.
Anybody who wants to get their book and get it signed. Thank you very much.
Okay, that was just a little announcement in the back. Thanks for sticking with it. If you're watching this retrospectively, I hope you found something interesting and insightful in the presentations today. So from me, Gavin Taylor, from Independence Live, thanks for watching. Cheers, bye.